Welcome everybody. So this is our public meeting for Keep 5G out of Wolseley. And we're going to be starting with the speakers, but we have a special treat before that. And I would like to introduce our very own Kate Shand with her and her ukulele.
I want to have another round of applause for Mark. She's done so much work, and she was grassroots doing it all by herself until she had two people join her, and then four people, and then 10, and then tons of people were joining her after a while. But she was going at it from by herself, and she was so passionate, and now she's done all this. So please, another round of applause for Mark.
Higher speeds, millimeter frequencies, killing the flowers, poisoning the bees, technology taking control. How long before it's too late to say no? They manufacture consent when we stay out of it. There's no proof it's safe, and I'm not a lab rat. Our higher network speeds worth the disease. Raise the vibration, not the radiation. Stand up, you and me, keeping Wolseley 5G free. Raise the vibration, not the radiation. Stand up, you and me, keeping Wolseley 5G free. Killing trees, poisoning birds and bees. Our home, humanity. We don't want your smart cities. Lockdown of humanity. Invasion of our privacy. It's not cool. Burning tires on hospitals and schools. No long-term safety testing. What kind of future for our children are we investing? Raise the vibration, not the radiation. Stand up, you and me, keeping Wolseley 5G free. Raise the vibration, not the radiation. Stand up, you and me, keeping Wolseley 5G free. 5G free. 5G free. So we can 533. Élever la vibration par la radiation. Restons-nous ensemble. Protéger notre communauté. Élever la vibration par la radiation. Restons-nous ensemble.
Thank you very much. That was fabulous. So I'd like to introduce first Lyle Barkman, who many of you may know if you're from the community, and if you don't know, you do know him indirectly, but I will let him take over from here. Lyle?
Thanks, Mark. It's good to see you all here tonight. My name is Lyle Barkman, and I've lived in the Wolseley community for over 32 years now, I guess. About 30 years ago, several of us here in Wolseley started a business creating organic-based food. Among other concerns, this was done in order to respond to the rural use and overuse of pesticides in farm production and focused on organics. I'm here today because I think we're facing another environmental threat, namely wireless radiation from small cellular antennas, basically cell towers, to be installed throughout our community. In some places in Canada, these antennas have been installed every 6 to 10 homes. These antennas, basically mini cell towers, will be initially emitting 4G, which we now use for our cell phones, and which even the city report says are not needed in most parts of the city. Next, when the technology is ready, will come 5G and other Gs. Based on a City of Winnipeg report of May 13th, there will be at least 3,400 and perhaps more than 7,000 small cell antennas attached to lampposts, hydro poles, and traffic lights throughout the neighborhoods of the city. We estimate at least 50 small antennas in Wolseley. The city's report says these may be 10-plus year contracts. Initially, antennas will emit 4G frequencies and can be upgraded with 5G with new frequencies. These frequencies are on top of the 4G frequencies. Once up, they will be hard to get shut off or removed, and we'll have no say as to where these antennas are placed. There has been no long-term health safety testing done on 5G technologies. None. As you will hear from the other speakers, there are some very serious concerns with the 4G and the preceding 2G and 3G. We have some pictures you can look at the information table and websites you can visit later to see what these antennas may look like. Trials in Winnipeg of these small antennas in preparation for 5G are coming, and a pilot project with Manitoba Hydro appears to be here already. The trials are to see, among other equipment testing, how telecommunications companies can cooperate to have shared spots. So there could be more than one antenna on one location. Even though it seems that the city is waiting to hear from the public before going forward, we have found out that Manitoba Hydro is allowing a telecommunications company to conduct a pilot project involving 12 poles. Manitoba Hydro has control of what is placed on Winnipeg lampposts and hydro poles. Whether it has the city's permission to do this or is able to do this on its own, we don't know. As it is now, public consultation is not required under the current City of Winnipeg cell antenna siting policy because the antennas are going on non-tower structures. The city will be revising this policy based on trials. The city has also told us that the public will be informed and be able to provide feedback through its public engagement system, like the one held here in Wolseley with regard to bike routes. Now is the time to let your councillors know that you do not want a cell antenna close to your home or schools or other places children spend a lot of time. The city is limited in what it can do because it is the federal government that gives the final approval, but the city is not powerless, and we will hear more about this later. If we let this go unchecked, it will just be the start. These hydro pole and lamppost installations will in all likelihood be upgraded, and this will make exposures to untested technologies even greater, with 5G and future Gs. This will happen without notification or public consultation. I am just not into having mini cell towers that will escalate in strength as time goes on my street. I drive an electric vehicle. I also use a cell phone, but use it now only whenever necessary. This is an important piece. I have a choice now. With the installation of these cell antennas in front of our homes, we will not have a choice. We will just be irradiated 24/7, whether we use any wireless devices or not. You'll be hearing about long-term health effects from the other speakers, but I want to say a few words about short-term health effects. It took me the better part of the last decade of virtually unlimited exposure to my cell phone to develop electrical sensitivity. My symptoms included heart palpitations, head sensations, kind of like the beginning of a tension headache, and cranial bone ache if I don't have a filter attached to my cell phone, as well as dry eyes. These were not pre-existing conditions in my life. We have some good material up here on symptoms, by the way, that you can pick up. I expect that some of you are already experiencing them from your phone and Wi-Fi systems at home and at work, and I have heard about reactions even from the large cell towers that already surround us. We're almost within view of the cell tower structure on top of the old Paradise restaurant. I urge you to check this out. You may be trying now to cover up the symptoms with medication. That's a natural response. Experts say, and this is my experience too, that it's easy to test out. Simply ease up on your usage or proximity to your cell phone, Wi-Fi routers, and other wireless devices for a time, and you may notice an easing of the symptoms. I certainly did. So my cell phone went outside of my bedroom. It also went on to airplane mode for the night or off. My staff need to call me. They use my landline. My house and office are hardwired with the Wi-Fi option turned off. I try to keep the cell phone off my body and use the speakerphone. When I drive, my phone is also on airplane mode or turned off, and it actually saves me quite a bit in cell phone tickets. I try to be 1 or 2 meters from my cell phone when it is on. I can still hear it ring. That's kind of all you need. Recently, I was recharging my car at one of Petro-Can's new electric chargers on the number one highway. The first pump went down, and the Petro-Can IT guy from somewhere in Canada that I phoned had to bring in that program called TeamViewer onto the pump screen to sort it out. By the time he had checked it out, 30 or 40 minutes later, I had my cell phone to my head as it was too noisy from the highway to use speakerphone. My head felt like it had been totally radiationally zapped, which I guess it actually had been. There was no missing that symptom. Surveys conducted in several countries between 98 and 07 estimate that approximately 3 to 13% of the general population experiences symptoms. I wonder to myself whether our devices have become even more powerful in the last 13 years. Together with the increasing natural vulnerability, as it happened with me, with time, I think that a significant amount of the population is going to have trouble with this. About 20 years ago, my house and probably many more in Wolseley were serviced with a hardwire connection. I just continued with that connection, turned off my Wi-Fi and hardwired my house. And we did the same at work with my office. I think we should continue in that direction. It's safer and even more dependable. One more interesting point that I want to draw out here is concerning insurance coverage. I don't think the city of Winnipeg or Manitoba Hydro, and indirectly the public, all of us who pay the bills, want to become liable for this new wave of technology. I'm just going to quote Professor Anthony Miller, MD of the Dalhousie School of Public Health in the University of Toronto, in a letter dated this year, February 4th, to the press and various politicians. And I quote, "Those who support the introduction of 5G should recognize that no insurance agency, including Lloyd's of London, will cover them against liability from ill health effects caused by radio frequency radiation," end of quote. So it seems like the insurance industry already knows. So who will be on the hook when this proposed initiative turns bad? At times like this, we should be able to turn to federal health guidelines and standards for protection. In this case, Safety Code 6. But Barry is going to talk to us. Well, not but. Now Barry is going to talk to us about the problems with that avenue. Thanks for listening. I'll be around afterwards if you have questions that I can answer. It's more about my personal experience. Marg is the science question go-to. Thanks for listening.
Thank you, Lyle. So I just want to, before introducing Barry, I just want to show you what these small cells may look like. So this is one of them. They're not very big. It's probably bigger than that and a bit grayer. Or they may look like those cylinders that you see there. There are many different varieties. And we have some pictures over at the table there. Now, some people say, oh, they're smaller, so they're not going to be emitting as much. But actually, they are reaching in other areas of, especially in Europe. And also, I just got an email from Australia, where they're actually much higher than the bigger towers are. And to some places, they're approaching the already very high exposure level standards that people have in different countries. And the other thing to realize is nobody's measuring this. Unless you have your own meter, you will not be able to know what the reading is, because there's no routine monitoring. You have to complain, and then they'll come out and do some measuring. So anyway, this is what could be in store for us. And certainly in Mission, BC, we've got a great picture of that. There are, within about six or seven houses, they have three poles, and a couple of the poles have got two of these on them. So that's the other thing they're looking at, is sharing, so that, you know, if they pick a location, we could have different companies put up their own little cell antenna. So our next speaker is Barry Malawanchuk. He's a former telecommunications engineer with Manitoba Hydro and an amateur radio operator. Barry has presented at the City of Winnipeg committees when the city was reviewing the Winnipeg antenna siting policy in 2015. And more recently, as it's dealing with the permitting and the implementing of small antennas throughout Winnipeg. He was awarded the Manitoba Hydro Professional Engineer Safety and Workplace Health Award in 1993. That was the first time it was awarded. It was in response to a problem that identified where hazardous voltages could appear on communications cables leaving power stations. This exposed Hydro and MTS, Manitoba Telephone System, staff and equipment, and resulted in Hydro spending $6 million over 6 years on a province-wide upgrade program, and Hydro taking over all communications cable facilities entering the station so that the construction standards developed could be maintained. Barry graduated with his engineering degree from the University of Manitoba in 1974 and retired after 37 years in 2011. Since then, he's traveled worldwide and has given many papers and has also written papers that have been published on fish feed horns, solid state and vacuum tube power amplifiers. He has received the Central States VHF Society John Chambers Award in 2000 and again in 2008, and also a Microwave Development Award in 2003, and the Northern Lights Radio Society's Westland Award in 2008. Please help me welcome Barry.
Thanks, Margaret. Good to see everyone here. Hope my voice lasts. It usually doesn't. And I've got, okay. Yeah, I'm used to that, so. I've got quite a bit of material here to go over. I'm used to using PowerPoint and not reading from a script sort of thing, so sorry if I don't look up at the audience as much as I normally would. So, in support of my amateur radio hobby and my work at Manitoba Hydro, I became concerned with RF radiation safety. Of course, Hydro operates lots of transmitters and such devices as part of our work, microwave transmitters and other things that are conducted on the wires. But I became familiar with Health Canada's Safety Code 6, because that was the standard that you could hold up and say, okay, as long as we're within those limits, we're fine. Since retiring, I have seen and I've become concerned that Safety Code 6 does not deal with long-term exposure to RF radiation at all, and even at levels far below the Safety Code 6 admissible levels. So this is a big concern. So Health Canada Safety Code 6, the latest version was done in 2015. It sets the safety limits for human exposure to RF frequency radiation in the range of 3 kilohertz to 300 gigahertz, which is about 10 times as high in frequency as 5G will go, but that's beside the point. It's still radio spectrum. Health Canada recommends limits for safe human exposure, but does not regulate the general public's exposure to the radiation. It's innovation, science, and economic development. ISED Canada adopted Safety Code 6 as their standard, and they apply it to the regulation of wireless devices such as cell phones and cell towers and broadcast undertakings, anything that emits radiation, RF radiation. There is strong evidence that Safety Code 6 does not protect Canadians' health, nor does it address potential harm to the natural environment. Health Canada's process in updating Safety Code 6 in 2015 was swift and deeply flawed. They basically ignored all the science that was available. The Safety Code 6 guidelines for the frequencies used for telecommunications are based on the premise that the radiation causes harm only at exposure levels that produce excessive heat. In other words, if it doesn't cook you, it's okay. Simply put, Health Canada says if it doesn't heat, it doesn't harm. This premise is outdated and has been disproven, but they still choose to ignore it. So looking at the present RF environment that we're exposed to, this is pre-5G, you know, we've got all kinds of cell phone stuff. There's been hundreds of peer-reviewed scientific publications that describe biological effects and harms with exposures far below Safety Code 6. In humans, plants, for example, trees, laboratory animals, and wildlife such as birds and birds and the bees, the pollinators. In spite of claims to the contrary, our guidelines for radiation emissions lack far behind and are greatly in excess of those of many other countries, including China, Russia, parts of Switzerland, and Italy. And you would think China and Russia, you know, they don't care about their people, but they do care about the radiation limits. So, in terms of biological effects, existing cellular antennas emit RF radiation, as we know, which is scientifically demonstrated to cause or contribute to numerous health effects, including cancers, sperm damage, reproductive harms, learning and memory deficits, neurodegenerative, cellular, and genetic damage. Boy, that's a mouthful. A growing number of Canadians also experience immediate and debilitating health problems such as headaches, irregular heartbeats, cognitive difficulties, and insomnia, resulting in a poor quality of life. Well, Lyle already mentioned the effect that it had on him. So, you know, there are real people that have these problems. All Canadians are susceptible to developing such health issues unless their ever-increasing exposure to RF radiation is curtailed, which is what Lyle is doing. He's minimizing his exposure to it. There's also chemical effects. You know, besides the effects at non-heating levels documented in biosystems, there's also supporting evidence from chemistry. They have something called microwave-assisted chemistry, which accelerates particular chemical reactions with low non-heating levels of RF frequency radiation. And they've even commercialized that. In living systems, the acceleration of some chemical reactions would cause molecular damage, chemical imbalances, and dysfunction. This is consistent with observations of significant effects seen in humans, animals, plants, and isolated cells. So that's the existing situation pre-5G. Now, what's 5G? Well, as Lyle, I think, suggested, 5G refers to the fifth generation of wireless technology. Its intended purpose is to provide faster and higher speed capacity transmissions to carry the massive amount of data that industry projects will be generated from the Internet of Things, smart cities, driverless cars, video streaming, augmented reality, and more. It is not yet clear how 5G will be achieved, so at present, it is being used more as a marketing term. I mentioned my voice would give out. Okay, where are we here? Okay, so It's not clear how 5G is going to be yet achieved, so at present it's more of a marketing term. Presently, plans for 5G are that it will use new frequencies just above the present 4G frequencies. So, you know, it's just more and a little bit better data speeds, but not the super high speeds that they've been planning. So it's clear that the plan is for 5G, though, to move to higher millimeter wave frequencies never used before for internet or telecommunications, for personal telecommunications. Industry has been using it, but it's on a point-to-point basis, rooftop to rooftop, and not touching the ground. So microwave dishes, if you look over there at some of the buildings just on Portage Avenue. Now, millimeter waves, these waves don't travel well through buildings or trees. So according to industry, 5G would require hundreds of thousands of new so-called small cells located closely together. You know, on, let's say, alternating lampposts on your street sort of thing. The wireless telecom industry is aggressively seeking to outfit lampposts and utility poles around the country. As mentioned, they are just starting to look at that here. You know, no big implementation yet, but it wouldn't take long once they get started. So anyway, they're wanting to, on these poles and lamp standards, put microwave antennas that are going to beam hazardous radiation next to and into our homes 24/7, not intermittently. It's going to be always on. So 5G cell tower antennas will be supplemented and integrated by the use of satellites. Elon Musk has been launching dozens and dozens, I forget what it is, it's like 500 of them up now. They're expecting to have thousands to be scheduled in service before 2021 to ensure that every inch of the planet is sufficiently irradiated to support ubiquitous high-speed wireless capability. I personally don't believe that the satellite systems are a major concern, but it's an unknown because it isn't running yet. They're actually talking about this August starting to run some trials now with the satellites that they have up there. And as Margaret mentioned, if you don't have a meter to measure, you don't know what's hitting you. So, you know, it's to be seen. So Lyle mentioned there's no safety testing that's been done on 5G to ensure that the technology is safe for humans and the natural environment. In addition to the possible harm from the lower frequency 5G emissions that are similar to what you're getting now with 4G, the 5G millimeter radiation may cause overheating of small invertebrates such as insects and including bees. And this that may sound strange, but it's actually not unlike the original concerns that I had when I was working at Hydro with FM and TV broadcasting transmissions on human bodies. TV transmitters are on radio towers. Some of them were hydro-owned towers. And if you're sending a tower climber up past a TV antenna that's transmitting 20 kilowatts of RF power, that body will get heated up. And if he lingers by the antenna, he'd actually get overheated. So do that on a small scale with short wavelengths where the body of an insect actually will resonate at that frequency, and it'll be the same thing. So if you actually look at the safety code 6 for the human body, they have a little, you know, take the levels down because that's where the human body is resonant, and you can run higher levels on other frequencies. So and it's interesting that the Russians did research, and this research was declassified by the CIA in the United States in 2012 after covering it up for 35 years, that shows there are countless biological effects at very low radiation levels, and especially at millimeter wave frequencies. And these are the frequencies that 5G is going to bring. So, you know, that's part of the reason the Russian radiation standards are lower, because they know there's an issue there. So there are safer alternatives. Fiber optics and wired connections can provide internet access that is safe, faster, reliable, resilient, secure, affordable, and in the long term, more environmentally and economically sound than wireless connections. So going forward, we need to do something about this. So in a perfect world, all telecommunications providers should be required to connect fiber directly to your home and to connect to wireline equipment inside the premises, and don't replace the existing wired telephone that you have and internet services with wireless. Like, Wi-Fi is handy, but it is still radiating, so you need to minimize that, and if you can use a wired connection, use it. Immediately suspend the installation of new antennas, especially small cell antennas near homes, hospitals, schools, public buildings, and sensitive wildlife habitats until safety guidelines have been appropriately revised and implemented. We could also immediately suspend the auctioning and transferring of all spectrum licenses. This is for new cellular frequencies for 5G until safety guidelines have been appropriately revised and implemented, and until the total economic implications are understood. Like, what is the health impacts? You know, who pays the health bills? Not the feds, but they get all the money from these spectrum auctions. So anyway, Canadians' health and environment should be protected further before the rollout of the wireless infrastructure for 5G. Health Canada Safety Code 6 must be revised. A truly independent panel with appropriate expertise must systematically review the scientific evidence of the effects of radiation, which they haven't done to this point. This requires rigorous scientific methods, transparency, full public consultation from initial scoping through the process, and health protective precautionary interpretation of the findings. Binding guidelines must be established to protect wildlife and the environment from RF radiation using a similar process. Building on the regulation of chemicals, the burden of proof should be shifted to the telecommunication industry, so the requirement is that it proves its products are not harmful to Canadians or the environment. So the other thing that can be done is keep as low as possible, or as low as reasonably achievable, indoor and outdoor exposure to RF radiation from wireless technologies. So through proper regulation, monitoring, enforcement, and ongoing public education and technical device management. One of many examples would be to require that some of the wireless devices, example cordless phones, not transmit or emit radiation really when they're not in use. So there's quite a bit of controversy about that in Europe. Some of the countries there have legislated that the emission levels have to go so low that the cell providers are saying, well, it's not even practical to put a 5G system in place. Anyway, that's it in a nutshell. I'll turn it back to Margaret.
Thank you, Barry. Okay, can you hear me still?
So tilt it up towards your mouth a little bit.
Yeah. There, is that better? Yeah. That's better, isn't it? Okay, good. Thank you very much, Barry. I just want to mention that we have three tables here. Those tables have got handouts. I'm going to talk about the handouts when it's my turn to speak. This third table here has got some meters at it as well. So afterwards, don't all please rush there now. Afterwards, if you're curious to know how the signal on your cell phone works, you can go over there and try it. So there are safer ways to use that kind of technology even now. So we can talk about that a little bit later, maybe in the question and answer period. So it's my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Jean-Paul Dorst, or JP as he likes to be called. He has a PhD in biophysics from the Max Planck Institute in Germany, which he received in 1979. The next 4 years he worked in nuclear waste management for the German and French governments. JP came to Canada in 1983 and was a professor of physics at St. Boniface College, teaching from 1989 to 1992. And then he moved on, and that was in French, and then he moved on to the University of Manitoba, where he taught physics in English. From 1992 to 1998, he had his own company, which specialized in indoor air quality. In 1999, he turned his knowledge in physics and advanced statistics to linguistic mathematical research and development. When first coming to Winnipeg in the early 1980s, JP noticed that there were asbestos fibers in the water supply pipes that the city was installing in his area. So when I originally had this written, I said asbestos lined, and he said, no. He said those pipes were asbestos. And as many of you know, asbestos is now considered to be a known carcinogen. JP was instrumental in having the asbestos water supply lines used by the city at the time, and that authorities, by the way, had told him were not a health threat. Eventually, they were replaced with the safer type of pipe, and I'm going to let him tell you more about that now. Well, please help me welcome JP.
Thank you. As Margaret just said, I came to Canada in 1984. It was actually June 1984. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And when I came, I moved right away into a house in the south of Winnipeg, close to U of M. And after about 2 weeks, I found out that I seemed to be an individual who seems to be attracted somehow to environmental controversial issues. I saw city workers digging up asbestos pipes in that area. That was about the end of June, early July, 1974. So I was asking them, what are you doing here? What are these pipes for? And they told me, oh yeah, they are used to carry regular drinking waters into people's homes. And I said to them, based on what I know, asbestos is a carcinogen, so why do you do something here which could create cancer in people? And they said, they were told by the city there's no problem, because even if asbestos is inside the water, if you ingest water with asbestos inside, there's no negative health effect. Well, I knew that was true, but I also knew that there might be certain procedures in a regular household where someone boils water, you boil an egg, and what happens when you boil water? You have steam bubbles rising to the surface, and when they burst, they create aerosols. So what do you think is going to happen if you have water laced with asbestos, you boil it, you have the steam bubbles, they create aerosols? Of course, there will be asbestos inside those aerosols. And at the same time, I also noticed some articles written in the Free Press about this issue, about this topic, by a reporter of the name Barbara Robson, if I remember correctly. I met her a couple of times, and she said the same thing to me. There could be a problem if this asbestos is in the water, you boil it, and you have these bubbles. So I did some more research, and I found another more practical-oriented professor in physics at the U of M. His name was Professor Conor Pasek, and he told me, I have an experimental arrangement. We could do the following test. We could take drinking water from Winnipeg, laced with asbestos, boil it, see what we get. And he did this based on my suggestion, and he used his microscopic arrangement, and he found indeed naked solid asbestos particle on a filter. I was even able to make an estimate of the amount of asbestos he found in the diameters based on my previous experience from Europe when I, as Margaret said, worked for 3 to 4 years for the German and French government in the area of nuclear waste management. When you process nuclear waste to purify it, in many instances, you boil it in certain acids, and then for safety reasons, you have to make sure that the product which boils, like in water, if it carries dangerous aerosol into the air, they have to be captured by filters. And at that time, I built a theoretical physical model for those particles which could appear. And I was able to apply the same theory to the asbestos problem in Winnipeg. So Conor Pasek, he found those particles. So I went ahead, created a petition, went door to door, asking people to sign this petition and ask the city to replace these asbestos pipe by something safer. And I think they did that by the end of 1984. By that time, all the asbestos pipes were replaced by safe blue plastic pipes. Okay. Well, as I said, I seem to be attracted to controversial issues in environmental areas. Now I'm switching to our topic, which is also controversial, 5G. The first time I heard about 5G wasn't in Canada. I already came here, as I said, in 1984. I heard it from someone on the phone in Germany. I think it was 1994 or 1993. That person was my own dad. He was a GP from 1956 until 1974. Then he retrained himself for 2 years and became a neurologist from 1976 until 1995, and he retired, but he still did research on his own until he passed away. He passed away in April 2013. And he told me already about the risks and dangers and health threats related not to 5G, that was unknown at that time, but to microwaves in general. And he got lots of information through discussions with people he knew in East Germany, even in Russia. And that all happened after the fall of the Berlin Wall, after the fall of the Iron Curtain. So he told me stuff which at that time wasn't even published in English peer-reviewed journal. And he already knew about some of the mechanisms which you have when microwaves or radio waves at frequencies, I think was below 20 gigahertz at that time, interact with biological material, with biological tissue. Based on safety code fix, we know Health Canada says the only effect which is the threat for your health are thermal effects. While that is not true, there are other mechanisms at play. And I like to talk now a little bit about these other mechanisms, which are non-thermal effects. First of all, I like to talk a little bit about an effect which takes place in calcium. So I'm now talking about a summary of tests which have been done by English scientists and in those days by East German, Polish, Hungarian, and Russian scientists. Let's talk about calcium. Non-ionizing EMFs, they can affect calcium in cells. Calcium in cells is used to support the skeletal structure and function in many other roles, such as cell signaling, regulating enzyme and protein functions, muscle contraction, blood clotting, nerve function, cell growth, as well as learning and memory. So normally, the amount of calcium outside cells is about 20,000 to 100,000 times higher than inside cells. Calcium does not flow freely from outside to inside of cells for reasons of tight regulations. So the control of calcium from outside of cells to the inside occurs through what are called ion channels, which are embedded in the cell membrane, and they are assisted by proteins inside the lipid structure. Lipids are fatty compounds in a cell membrane. So these channels are also called VGCCs, which stands for voltage-gated channels. That's because of an equilibrium between diffusion and other electrophysiological processes in that cell. Now, in the early 90s, it was discovered, mainly in Russia and East Germany, that EMFs, they increase calcium levels inside the cells. They do that, they have enough energy to change the conformation of the proteins which are assisting the channel flux itself. The research confirmed that when calcium channels were blocked, damage caused by the EMFs, by the electromagnetic waves, was reduced considerably, which provides evidence that calcium channels were responsible for facilitating damage from EMFs. So it's a complete different mechanism, non-thermal. So excess calcium in cells creates free radicals, which lead to other disease-causing chain reactions. So there is an increase of nitric oxide as one of the results of these chain reactions, and superoxide, leading to another compound, which is called peroxynitrite, which is an extremely damaging molecule. So the damage induced by peroxynitrite is the result of its primary breakdown product, which is a carbonate free radical, which trigger breaks in the strand of DNA. So the energy we have here to trigger a break in DNA is not a photonic energy carried by EMF waves, it's actually chemical energy. Now I sidetrack a little bit, but let me talk a little bit about ionizing radiation, such as X-rays or gamma rays. They, of course, as most people know, they destroy cells by disrupting the atoms, they can remove electrons. But with ionizing radiation, there's another mechanism involved. If the EMFs, even with ionizing radiation, react with the water in a cell, that creates hydroxyl radicals. And these hydroxyl radicals also can destroy DNA. So we have direct ionization and indirect ionization by means of hydroxyl radicals when dealing with ionizing radiation. We have peroxynitrite leading to carbonate-free radicals doing cell damage when dealing with non-ionizing radiation. So when we talk about the destruction by EMFs through peroxynitrite, we have in essence three cascading amplification steps. When these voltage gating calcium channels are open, they allow influx of about 1 million calcium ions per second into the cell. That's when you have EMFs involved. So the elevated calcium inside the cell then activates the synthesis of nitric oxide and superoxide. And the third and last cascading step, peroxynitrite is formed in proportion to the product of nitric oxide concentration times the superoxide concentration. To understand all this, is also leads to a link between EMFs and cancer. When you have the increase in oxidative stress, which you have with these processes, that stress contributes to mitochondrial dysfunction, which is a major cause of DNA damage in cancer. Mitochondri are cell structures inside a cell which contains ATP, which is an energy generating molecule. So safety code 6, as we knew already from the previous speaker, only considers the avoidance or minimization of thermal effects and also avoidance and minimization of peripheral nerve stimulation. It completely ignores the mechanisms which I just described. So, and as Barry also said, in many instances, industry liability insurance providers do not offer coverage against adverse health effects related to EMFs. So how can you protect yourself now in general against microwave radiation? You don't even talk yet about 5G. Well, you can do what I do. I don't even have a cell phone. My computer is totally wired. I have a wired keyboard. I have a wired mouse. My Wi-Fi is completely switched off. I live in Winkler. So I had a cell phone for 1 year because I was afraid if I go in my car to Winnipeg in winter or come back when it's minus 40 degrees Celsius, there might be a situation where I might freeze to death. I might have to call CAA. That never happened, but I did one test and I found out somewhere close to, the thing was bronchial. There was no signal because there weren't enough towers. And I said to myself, if I can't even receive a signal, why do I need a cell phone? So I'm quite happy. I'm maybe one of the few people who don't need a cell phone, don't need a smartphone, don't have it at all, and I don't even plan to have one. Now, let me talk to you about some other things which are going on in other countries in regards to microwaves and 5G. I know, in fact, in France, cell phones, cell phones and Wi-Fi are completely banned in schools. I know that because I have family in France. My own sister is an MD in France, in the Alps, in Grenoble. I'm also afraid of cell phones for another reason. As I mentioned, there's the risk of cancer, in particular brain cancer. Well, I don't want to have another cancer. In order to understand the statements, you have to know I'm one of the very few males. I had breast cancer in 2000. So I don't plan to have another one at all. This is another reason why I don't use cell phones. Now, there are other areas, environmental areas, where microwaves, which are not 5G, and most likely 5G as well, they can create havoc among animal populations, such as birds, for instance. And I think Margaret is going to talk to this topic right now. Thank you for listening.
Margaret's been in and out of this microphone area quite a bit, but I want to now give her a real introduction. She's a former Government of Canada research biologist with more than 30 years' experience in original research projects that include freshwater ecosystem toxicology and DNA population genetics of wildlife. She has an honors bachelor's degree in zoology and a master of science degree in entomology from the U of M. She's devoted much of her time in the past 9 years working to achieve more protective wireless radiation safety standards for people and for wildlife. Sometimes in my ramblings about and thoughts about people, I forget about how much more vulnerable some of the wildlife is to some of our decisions, and how our lives, though, hinge on whether they're going to be healthy or not. This circle is a little insidious. She's written extensively about electromagnetic radiation effects on human health and the environment, and has given numerous presentations, including to the City of Winnipeg, when they reviewed their Winnipeg antenna siting policy in 2015, and more recently on small cell antenna permitting and implementation. In the 70s, Margaret was involved in public awareness campaigns for the health hazards of cigarette smoking and advocated for buffer zones for mosquito fogging. More recently, as a representative of the Environmental Health Association of Manitoba, she advocated for a ban on cosmetic pesticide use on lawns. Join me in welcoming Margaret.
Thanks very much, Lyle. So, I'm going to be, I don't know if everybody's got one of these. We've got handouts at the table. And I just want to sort of, for people who didn't have a handout, Lyle talked about the overview of more than 3,400 and perhaps more than 7,000 4G, 5G cell network antennas throughout Winnipeg, estimating to be about 50 in this area. Health Canada's, Barry talked about Health Canada's Safety Code 6 guidelines for antenna emissions that are not protective of human health. And Jean-Paul just talked about why radiation from cell antenna emissions is not healthy, and installations without informed consent is a human rights violation. I don't know if you want to, do you want to expand on that, or do you want me to talk about it? Okay. So, and now my title here, my topic here is environmental reasons to keep cell network antennas away from not only us, but also from birds, bees, and trees, and possible negative implications of 5G technologies on climate change and weather forecasting. And I think most of you would know that this is a topic that cannot be covered in like 5 or 10 minutes. So I think what I will do is I'm going to just briefly talk a little bit about the environmental aspects. And there is a lot of science indicating that non-human species are affected. In fact, every level, from bacteria to fungi to birds and bees, if they've been studied adequately under good conditions, have found adverse effects that have occurred. The adverse effects that have occurred in insects have pretty well been established in the lab. We don't know very much about the ecological consequences. There's only, considering there's been billions, literally, spent on that our government makes on selling spectrum and licensing spectrum, there's very little that's been put into the study of wildlife. One study that was done on ecosystems and insects, on pollinators, came to this conclusion. It was done in the Greek islands. It says, therefore, these changes in the composition of pollinator communities associated with electromagnetic smog may have important ecological and economical impacts on the pollination service that could significantly affect the maintenance of wild plant diversity, crop production, and human welfare. So it is in our best interest, I would say, that we study the implications of this, especially with all of the stuff coming from the sky, from the tens of thousands of satellites that are going up there, beaming out 5G, that we figure out what the implications are first. So that was a study done in the Mediterranean islands, by the way. The studies on birds, there was a very well-conducted study done out of Germany by Dr. Engel's research group, and they have pretty well have irrefutable evidence that radiofrequency radiation affects migration in some migratory birds. And an interesting study, I'm just trying to find it here, is they did a follow-up study, and they also found that the effect depended on the frequency. It's not as though you can just study one frequency and then you can apply it across the board. And if you look at that's if you look at the research that's been done, especially with the human research and with our lab animals, they'll often do just one frequency and they'll say, well, it's safe, we didn't find an effect. But really, you have to study more than one frequency. You have to study synergistic effects. What happens if you're dealing with chemicals that might be sequestered in the body? What if you have multiple electromagnetic fields coming at you? Well, what are those effects? And we really have next to no information on that. There's also the question of e-waste. So what 5G technology will bring? It'll bring new devices. It's estimated that in 10 years, there will be over 50 electronic devices per person on Earth. So those things have to be manufactured, and the whole story should be looked at from the manufacturing. Some of these are actually conflict minerals that are mined in the Congo. So there are human rights considerations right there. And then to realize, well, what happens then with them after they're disposed of? So what will happen with this 5G technology is they want people to buy new cell phones. So the old cell phones with the old technology aren't going to be working very well, so they want new devices to be purchased. And then, of course, there's the matter of e-waste. What happens to that? So there's the whole cycle that needs to be looked at. Something else which is a factor, especially from for weather forecasters, is the 5G that they want to emit from the satellites from space. So the weather forecasters from NOAA testified in Congress that this was going to put their ability to forecast weather back 40 years. So that means that it could delay forecasting tornadoes and things of that sort for days, which of course has got huge economical implications. So I just want to draw your attention to this document. We don't have copies of it, but I hope you'll go to our website, which is 5gwinnipeg.ca, and right off the hop, right at the beginning, you can see there's a button will pop up to sign the 5G suspend 5G Canada appeal. And this has now been signed by over 17,000 organizations. We have we've got over 17,000 signatures, and we've got over 40 organizations that support this. And this has got a lot of the information that I'm talking about in it. It's a well-referenced document. We participated in putting it together. Groups across Canada participated in putting it together. So I hope you look at this, because you'll find more information in it. The other thing that I hope you will visit our table. We have a handout. So we've got this handout, which is Winnipeg Stop 5G. So never tested for safety. So there's been no safety testing. There's been some testing on millimeter waves. There have been two recent reviews that have been done on it, and especially the skin, because this will only penetrate in the very superficial levels of our bodies, although there is science indicating that there are implications that are greater than that. But both of those very large reviews indicate we don't have enough information to go forward, not to say whether it's safe or not to go whether it's not safe. But you have to remember, 5G, the millimeter waves, does not replace the ones from the former Gs. So we've got all of the health implications that we've been talking about so far, and on top of that, we've got these small, teeny millimeter waves, which could be adding additional complexity to the whole situation. So if somebody says, oh, we've studied, you know, 24 gigahertz. Well, 5G is not about one wavelength. It's about the whole complex wavelength, or many, many different wavelengths or frequencies. So I just want to go through a little bit, quickly, this handout that we have. So I hope you'll stop and pick up a copy. So there's a bright yellow paper here, four pages, which I hope you'll take a look at. Now, what you have here, you've got a biologist who studied some wildlife, and I've certainly looked at a lot of literature for people. We've got a telecommunications officer. We've got somebody who's affected. We've got affected personally. I am too, by the way. I have electrical sensitivities. And then we have a biophysicist who's talked to you. So what we have with this letter is a letter that Dr. Anthony Miller, who's a well-respected Canadian MD and epidemiologist, he worked with the World Health Organization in 2011 and compiled the literature when the World Health Organization International Agency on Cancer classified radiofrequency radiation as a possible carcinogen. That was 2011. Since then, there have been a number of very big studies, animal studies. What that was based on mostly was human studies, and those were mostly brain cancer studies or brain tumor studies. There's also another acoustic neuroma, which isn't cancerous, but it can be deadly. So that classification, which meant there was some evidence, occurred in 2011. There have been a couple of major animal studies since then, which have found clear evidence of cancer. And as you heard JP talk about, there's also the mechanism is there. So that's the other thing they consider. So DNA, there's over 30 studies which show DNA damage below safety code 6 levels before our Canadian standards. So this letter is from Dr. Miller. And I approached him and asked him if he would send a letter to our head doctor, Dr. Rusin, and to Premier Pallister and our Health Minister Friesen, no relation, and to Mayor Brian Bowman. So I hope you'll have a look at this letter, because basically what he says now is if the science were looked at, this would be classified as a known carcinogen. So that puts it up with tobacco smoke and with asbestos. And the other thing to realize is that the International Agency on Research on Cancer is going to be reevaluating the science within the next 5 years. So what's going to happen if we have these cell antennas up in our communities and then they find out, oh, not such a good idea because the classification has been bumped up to a known carcinogen or a probable carcinogen. So there's another good reason to wait. We have a letter also from Dr. Bray. She's a doctor, medical director at the Environmental Health Clinic in Toronto at Women's College Hospital. And she's written a letter about electrical sensitivities, people who suffer from short-term effects. And here in Manitoba, we're treated for symptoms. There's no clinic that looks at the whole picture and tries to identify what might be the causes. We have a handout about Safety Code 6 that Barry talked about with lots of references. There's a handout for electromagnetic hypersensitivity. And then there's one on the environment. And it also talks about climate change, 5G, and the Internet of Things. If you're concerned about climate change, you should be concerned about 5G. The wireless uses much, much more energy than wired technologies. Wired technologies is the way to go. Fiber optics is the way to go. They're laying fiber optics to the premises in Linden Woods and in Island Lakes. So what that is they're laying cable to the property line, and then people will have an option to opt for wired to their home, and then I hope would opt for wired in their homes. Because if you opt for wireless in your home, you're basically putting a little cell tower right in your home. So that's one option, is fiber optics. The other one is what Lyle was talking about, is he's happy enough with what he has. So we don't need it for the cell phone reception that we have now. I know it's spotty. There's some areas that probably do need it, and those should be addressed because it can become a safety issue. But most of Winnipeg, and that's according to city staff, most of Winnipeg is actually well-serviced for cell phone reception. So this is something that we really need to look at, and not just blanket this. I don't know if anybody heard CBC this morning, but they had a fellow on who said that our city would be blanketed with these antennas, and he's definitely correct. So I hope you will look at this write-up. It's in the U.S., so they talk about coal. But there's a team out of McMaster University that has also looked at this, and that reference is in the 5G appeal. So when you go to the website, you'll be able to see that there. Now, just two more things. So the other thing we have a handout on is the rights of the child and a legal opinion. So Health Canada refuses to accept that there are non-thermal effects that should be taken into consideration when they set Safety Code 6. They're just very set on keeping it based on temperature. And people are realizing that this is going to have to go to court. So there is a lawsuit in the States right now by the Environmental Health Trust, and along with that is from the Children's Health Defense. So that's one to watch. And in Denmark, there was a lawyer called Christian Jensen, and he wrote a legal opinion on the rollout of 5G and whether it contravened human rights, and that was his conclusion. So the opinion conclusion is actually establishing a 5G network as it is currently described will be in contravention of current human and environmental laws enshrined in the European Convention of Human Rights, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, and the European guidelines, regulations, and the Berne and Bonn Conventions protecting natural habitat and migrating species. And most of those apply to the European scene, but the one that applies to us is the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. So I hope, if we have any lawyers in the crowd, that it would be great if we got somebody involved into looking into that more deeply. So last of all, we've also got a handout. We're going door to door. If you want to join us, please take a handout, and we go to different areas, and we've collected a nice assembly of people who have joined in this and realize how important it is. And so you can sign up. There's sign-up sheets on that side and sign-up sheets on that side. And I'm going to end with wireless safety tips. So with the wireless that we have now, there are things where it can be used more safely. So distance is your friend, duration is a factor. If you go over to the table and you get your cell phone tested, you realize that the peak of the signal happens when you're connecting. So one thing that you want to try to avoid if you're making a phone call is you don't want to, you know, tap in your numbers and then put it to your head, because those are the highest. That's when you get the highest signal. And also, if you don't get a very good signal, it gets very high. I just want to mention something. We actually have Canadian data that Health Canada is not telling you about.
And that is that when the World Health Organization, IARC, classified wireless radiation as a possible carcinogen, Canada was one of the 13 countries that was participated in that. And the Canadian data has actually been published now. It was published a couple of years ago. And what that data showed, and they've adjusted it for a number of different things, what the data showed is with the use of a cell phone for more than 558 hours, people are doubling their risk of getting glioma brain cancer. The other thing Health Canada is not telling you is about the research, or the documentation is more like it, that's been done in California. And that's where young women who have tucked their cell phones when they're on in their bras and have developed breast cancer right where they had their cell phones and right where the antennas were. And these are women that don't have the gene that makes them more susceptible. These are warnings that we should have out there. I would encourage everybody to watch the CBC program. It's a couple of years old, still good. It's called The Secret Inside Your Cell Phone. And it was done by Wendy Mesley in Marketplace. And what she did is she took went down to California and bought some popular cell phones and had them tested to see how the emissions compared with Health Canada's guidelines. So I'm not going to be a spoiler here. I'd like to, y'all to go watch that. But it's got more information on it, including the breast cancer work.